Mesdames et messieurs, accueillons la fantastique Ming Soul!
Say I'm insane. Merci, merci, merci.
Thank you. You make me feel very bienvenue. I adore Montreal. Now, I can only speak English. I speak a little bit of French, but not enough to have a conversation with you, so. But I love the fact that you speak French here. I absolutely do. It's really nice to have people say bonjour. And where I live, the second language is Spanish, and which is fine. I have no problem with it, except that I like French better. I studied them both in high school, and I don't remember a word of Spanish. But I can still say, je vous aime. So, anyway, I thought what I would do is just sit myself down. Let me know if I'm in the light, because even after years of being on film and stage, am I okay? Yeah. I thought I'd give you a little history of the Dreamlanders. So, I met John Waters, I think Patrick was saying, I met him in 1966, which is before most of you were imagined, before your parents knew each other. But I met him in 1966, which is nearly 50 years. It's an amazing thing to know somebody for that long and still be friends. So I met him in Provincetown, Massachusetts, on Cape Cod on some sunny afternoon. And that was in the early summer. By the end of the summer, we were roommates. He and I and about 40 other people were living together, which was very fun. But he was just a guy then. He had one 10-minute film to his credit. He was not famous. He wasn't John Waters. He was just a guy who was odd-looking. You know, he was a very odd-looking man. He had a short torso. He had a very long, very short legs and his long torso. And he wore striped jerseys and had this long, stringy hair. And he wore yellow glasses and did not have a mustache. The person who taught him to put his mustache on was my sister. Just so you know, she taught him how to use mascara to put his mustache on. So anyway, just so you know,
that's not scary.
There's a mustache there, but there's not much of one. So the augments it. It's real hair. Anyway, so that fall, he and I moved to New York for about a month. We had an apartment in the West Village. Neither one of us can remember where it was. And John got lonely for Baltimore, and I was terrified. New York terrified me. I mean, I got lost every time I went out. And New York is very scary. And I was a little girl. I mean, I was a small town girl. I was in Baltimore, suburban Baltimore. And then one night, so John went back and lived with his family, and I went back and lived with my mom. And then one day he called me up and said, "Hey, I'm making a movie. Do you want to be in it?" Well, duh. So I had a monkey fur jacket that John had taught me how to steal. John and I stole it together. We were at this place on 8th Street with upstairs. I mean, I don't know if any of you know what monkey fur looks like. I mean, I wouldn't wear fur now, but it was gorgeous, but it was ugly. And he looks at it, pulls it out from the right, goes, "Here, put this on. Just put this on and wear it out." So I put it on, put my coat on over it, and I walked out looking like, nah. You know, I was skinny back then, but I looked like, and I got away with it. So I had that jacket. So I was wearing, I put on this monkey fur jacket and went over and had Pat Moran spank me in front of the camera. And this movie is called Roman Candles, and you never have seen it, and you probably never will. It's not a show. Have you seen it?
I've seen it.
There's somebody here who has seen Roman Candles?
Yeah.
How did you see it?
The internet.
That's not Roman Candles. Oh, honey, this is the rosary is way past. No, it takes 3 8-millimeter projectors and a tape recorder to show it. You haven't seen it. It maybe it's part of one of the shows. But my mother saw it, and there's a scene in it with a nun in full makeup and a priest smoking dope and drinking beer. And she was so horrified that she didn't see another one of my films until Polyester, which was actually probably just as well. So anyway, that was our first film, and that was 8 millimeter. Some of it was black and white, some of it was color, and it was projected. You know, three images on the screen at the same time, and it was a quite interesting experience for me. But that was 8 millimeter, no sync sound. Then we moved on to 16 millimeter, no sync sound, and that was Mondo Trasho. And in Mondo Trasho, I play several roles, but in that was the first one I got killed in. I got stabbed in the head. Divine stabbed me in the head. Oh, no, wait a minute, no, that's, no, sorry. See, even I get confused. That was Multiple Maniacs. No, in Mondo Trasho, I dance topless. And then I get gang raped with a paper bag on my head. It's a really glamorous role. Have you seen it? Has anyone?
Yeah.
It's hard. It's hard to find. It's really hard to find. It's not shown often. But anyway, that was our 16 millimeter, black and white, no sync sound. So we moved on from there. Now John did a couple of shorts in between Mondo Trasho and the next film, which was Multiple Maniacs. And I was not in either of those. So I'm not in any of his short films. I'm in every feature, but not in any of the short films. And so we moved on from there to Multiple Maniacs. Now Multiple Maniacs was sound. We had 16 millimeter black and white sync sound. And that was exciting for us. I mean, we actually had dialogue, which we had to learn. And John wrote, just to set everybody straight, John wrote every word any of us ever said on screen. There was no improvising. He wrote the commas. He wrote every single word. And he made sure that we said them right. He would stand behind the camera. I want to do this because that was like, in the early films he actually had one of those cameras where you had to do, you stand behind the camera and mouth all our dialogue. So he knew it all. He knew every word we were going to say. But that was where, that's the rosary. So now, the thing that was very special about doing Multiple Maniacs was I'm a cradle Catholic. If you don't know what that means, since I was born a Catholic, I grew up Catholic. And when I was a Catholic child, you know, we had the medieval nuns. This was before Vatican II. We had rules. We had very serious rules that had to be followed, that could not be broken, because if you broke a rule and you died without going to confession, you would go to hell. And that meant having a piece of bacon on a Friday afternoon. If you had a BLT on Friday afternoon, and you got hit by a bus, and I lived in fear of this bus, this imaginary bus that was gonna get me. It had my name on it, which was Nancy, by the way. So Nancy Stoll was written in big letters. Actually, by that time, I was Ming. John changed my name. I asked him to give me a name, because I thought Nancy Stoll was a little sibling. And he came up with Ming Stoll, the precious jewel. JEW-EL. Well, that's too big for a poster, so we changed it. We dropped it for the next film. Also, I'm not Jewish. Obviously, I was Catholic. So I'm culturally Catholic. I'm intellectually an atheist, but I'm cultural Catholic. And we have these, we had these rules, and they were very strict rules. And, you know, but the sphere of hell in this bus, maybe the bus said, Nancy, you are going to hell. But anyway, I lived in fear of this bus. So when I was about 14, I actually skipped Mass one Sunday, which you can't do that. You know, now you can go to Mass on Saturday afternoon, you can go or not go, it's really okay. You can eat all the meat you want on Friday, you can do everything you want, but you can no longer buy your way out of purgatory with prayer. I think that was the one benefit that we got. If you said a certain amount of Hail Marys or Our Fathers, you never had to go to hell. And you didn't have to spend any time in purgatory. So this was nice. But anyway, so one Sunday, a friend of mine talked me into skipping Mass. And I did. We went over to her grandfather's house because he had color TV and one of those chairs that went up and down the stairs. So instead of going to church, I went and rode a chair and watched color TV because that was a big deal back then. And the bus didn't come. I was free. I really thought that the first time I stepped out of line, that bus was gonna get me. And when the bus didn't come, and I wasn't hit, and I didn't get killed, everything fell apart. So here I am, you know, years later, not that many years later, but a few years later, in a Catholic church, and I get to do dirty, nasty sex with a drag queen. It was so much fun. That was another one my mom didn't see. She died a Catholic. I mean, she stayed Catholic all the way through. So anyway, I want to make sure I'm not falling out of the mic. So we did that, and that was the one where I played Divine's girlfriend. And that was the movie where Divine stabbed me in the head and I died. And Cookie Mueller played her daughter. So then we moved on from 16 millimeter black and white color, black and white sync sound, to 16 millimeter color sync sound, and that was Pink Flamingos. So we had already done a lot of film work before we got to Pink Flamingos. We were seasoned pros by the time we got to Pink Flamingos. And that was, who knew? It's really hard for me still to wrap my mind around the fact that something that I did 45 years ago still resonates and you all still care about it. And thank you very much. Yeah. And thank you very much for that. And I loved Connie Marble, and I loved working with David Lockery. I mean, I love working with Divine, but I love working with David Lockery. And whenever I see these, and periodically I'm out in the world, and I'm surrounded by little punk kids who look at me like, oh, who is that old lady? And I look at them and I go, you know, I was wearing black fairy nail polish in 1967, and I did not go to the drugstore to buy my hair color. Yeah. I went to the stationery store. That red hair color was done, but David Lockery would bleach my hair out until it was completely white, and then I would put ink on it. And that's how that color came about. And David Lockery was taking the inserts out of magic markers to get that blue on his hair. These were not party colors. You didn't find these anywhere. So, you know, these little punks of today have it easy. So don't be talking to me about no punks. Anyway, but I mean, we never thought of ourselves as punks because punks hadn't been invented yet. We never thought of ourselves as hippies because hippies didn't wear makeup. You know, so we wore lots of makeup. I used to wear 4 pairs of eyelashes at a time to go to the grocery store. I got over it. Anyway, so that was Pink Flamingos. And I mean, any of you, we will have a question and answer period when I finish talking, so they're, you know, save them up because I will answer them. Then we moved on to. Thank you! I forget sometimes, there's a lot of them. We went on to Female Trouble. Now, Taffy was my favorite in my life. I have always loved Taffy the best. Taffy was a lovely, unhappy child. Taffy was not retarded. She was unhappy and she just wanted some peace and some have a good time in her life. Something good to happen for her, yes. And I mean, she was nice to Edie in the birdcage. Yeah. I gave her a claw. Yeah. I gave her a hook. I did. So, but I love Taffy because I mean, Taffy was more. I mean, I did not walk around when I was 14 years old in baby clothes. And my mother didn't beat me with a car antenna. My parents were so devout that they had 10 children.
Oh.
So I am the fifth of 10 children. And I, the Catholic, and I would have sold every one of them for a dress that hadn't been worn by 4 older sisters. And that is the truth. I like them now most of the time. You know, and I will say most of the time, because the last time I saw them, I'm still a little annoyed, but we'll get them. But most of the time, I like them. Anyway, so we had Pink Flamingos. And Pink Flamingos was, Vincent Perenio was the set deck, was the production designer. He came on the scene Multiple Maniacs. He made Love Stora. Do you remember Love Stora?
Oh, yeah.
He made Love Stora. Yeah. And he was actually inside Love Stora. He and his brother were manipulating Love Stora. Paper mache, big paper mache lobster crawling across the floor. And Vincent and I had been sweethearts. We were sweethearts for a little while, but we broke up right before Pink Flamingos. So on one Sunday afternoon in Provincetown, because John and I, the whole gaggle of us would migrate to Provincetown for the summers. And we were sitting on the benches in front of City Hall, Town Hall, not City. We were in front of Town Hall, and John said to me, this is before we made the movie, he said, would you set your hair on fire for the next movie? And I was all despondent over, you know, breaking down the fence, and I said, yeah, sure, why not? Well, then as the time to actually do this got closer and closer and closer, I knew I was going to be able to do it. Because, first of all, from an acting standpoint, I was supposed to sit and not notice. While some idiot with a match just, you know, lit my hair on fire, and some other idiot with a bucket of water stood by to throw it, to put it out. I knew I was not going to be able to give John the scene that he wanted. So I told him I wouldn't do it, and he was not happy with me. He had already bought the wig that I was going to wear while my hair grew back in. He had made the investment. He doesn't like it when his investment's done. John is not one of those people that you say no to. So he was not happy. But you know, I've never regretted it. Because what would have happened by the end of the movie when spoiler alert, by the end of the movie when Divine eats the dog shit, nobody would have remembered. I would probably be bald today. And the scene would have gone very badly and been cut out of the movie. So, you know, it wasn't a bad decision. We move on from there to female trouble. And I did love to have it. I digress. I do have a lot in my own life. I talk to myself around my apartment constantly, and I'm always losing track of what I'm saying. So for female trouble, I love Taffy. I really did love Taffy. And and I love my scenes with Divine. You know, I mean, we had a really good working relationship, and I would have to work so hard because Divine was this really imposing presence. You know, I'm tall, big, wig, heels, and, you know, that fabulous wardrobe that Van Smith did. Van Smith should have been nominated for an Oscar for that movie. Without question. He's been absolutely overlooked as a fabulous designer, and it's a real shame. Anyway, but I love my scenes with Divine. I really thought that after I was killed, there should have been a long, lingering shot of my body lying on the floor so that everybody in the audience could realize how momentous an occasion it was. And I didn't get that. So then we moved on. So after that, we came to Desperate. It's not my favorite. It's not. It's so loud. I mean, I think they should hand out ear plugs to every single person that enters the theater because it just yelling. I mean, I start off yelling and I never stop. Don't tell me. I don't remember the lines, but this isn't some communist daycare center. Thank you. I mean, I think it's a terrific movie, and it was our first movie that we made without Divine, which was very interesting, and Susan Lowe, who is a very good friend of mine, and she's still alive, so many of us are dead. It's really nice that Susan's still with us. So, but she did a great job as Molly.
Oh, yeah.
But there's that, when she blows the snot out, the snot is spoiled. Yeah. I'm not good. I'm squeamish. I don't like horror movies. Fake blood scares me. Anyway, so we did Desperate Living, and I got to work with Liz Renee, and I also that brought us Jean Hill.
Oh yeah.
And Jean Hill was a piece of work. Let me tell you, she was lovely, and she was funny, and she was such a good sport. Except in the scene where she and I are loaded into the paddy wagon and we have to kiss. She's like, oh, I can't kiss you. And I'm looking at her, finally I said, Jean, your lips are bigger than my head. If I can kiss you,
you can kiss me.
Now, I have one brother-in-law, I have many in-laws, but I have one brother-in-law who saw that movie, and it's the only thing he could ever think to say to me. Has he seen any 400-pound black women around? No, not lately. And then finally, when G-Tail died a few years ago, which is very sad, I finally told him, I said, you can't ask me anymore, she's gone. So I don't get that one anymore. It's like, that's kind of sad when the only thing somebody can say to you is that. I love Jean Hill. She was fun. She was a lot of fun. And by the way, just another spoiler alert, when I go down on her, this woman was so fat. She was four times my size. She was literally, she weighed four times what I weighed. Because I was still skinny back then. Those were the days, I must say. She was so fat that I could not see anything. I scooched down there at the end of the bed, you know, while John was filming, and she's going, "Ooh, Peggy, get it!" But I was seeing nothing. It was layer upon layer upon layer. It was like braided thighs. A very mean thing for me to say. But anyway, so from there, we move on to what's next? Polyester. Well, I liked polyester, but it ruined my hair. I have to say, the hair that I lost with those bloody cornrows, I will never get back as long as I live. I mean, I came out of that, my hair was so dim. I loved it, though. I mean, they were fun. And John told me cornrows, but I did the actual design. But they were, you know, it was very heavy. I had sex one time while I had those cornrows in. I found beads all over the bedroom floor the next day. That was fun. Woo! Get it! But I think that the Divine did a brilliant job. I thought Divine was always good. I'm always brilliant, but I loved him in polyester, and it was lovely to meet Tab Hunter. I didn't have any scenes with him, which was unfortunate, but he was so pleasant, and he was having so much fun, and obviously, he and Divine hit it off, and went on to make Lost in the Dust, so I mean, he became, you know, some people come in and they become part of the family, and other people come in and then they go, and you never see them or hear from them again, so it was nice. Tab became kind of a member of the family, which was lovely.
It was hard.
It was hot. Yeah. And there's a movie out about him now. Have you seen it? It's really good. It's by the same man, Jeffrey Schwartz, who made I Am Divine. And it's really quite a good movie. I liked it a lot. I didn't know that he sang the song Young Love. I remember the song. I just never knew it was Tab Hunter. I don't know if I'm getting to any of you people upstairs, but there's a light right in my face, so it's really hard for me to look up, but I don't mean to be ignoring you. So anyway, so that was polyester. That was the first movie that my mother saw. She was able to, John made her. She wasn't gonna go because I wanted her to. But John told her, you really should see this, it's okay. And the worst thing that I did was dance in my underwear, so it was, talk about condos. So that was fine. I mean, I wasn't doing anything really bad. So then we went on to, what was next? Hairspray. And hairspray changed the world. Hairspray changed everything. Hairspray was so much fun, and I got to be one of the good guys. This was the first time in any of the films that I, first of all, I didn't die. You know, I mean, I died so many ways. I was shot in the head, I was in polyester, I was strangled with macrame, I was stabbed in the head, in Desperate Living, I was shot up the butt. And the cute little story about being shot up the butt, I just have to tell you, was after the scene was shot, John said, just lie there for a minute. And so I stayed there, I stayed in dead pose, and then I felt something slimy on my behind. John took a piece of raw liver and put it on my butt to film it. Why? So it looked more like I had been shot. So, you know, so there would be some realism. We were doing everything so realistic. That was very important that we be believable. Actually, we were. believable. We created these very weird realities, but we did make them believable.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, which was the thing, I used to get very upset. I don't anymore, but I used to get very upset when people would call us an amateur troupe. Because we were not amateurs. We were untrained. We were, at this point, not part of the union. That came with Hairspray. But we came to work on time. We knew our lines. We did our job. And we did a damn good one. And that's what being a professional is.
So I would get very upset with you.
We were real. Yeah. But, you know, you show up, you do your job. That's what you do.
You're so
thank
God.
Now, in Desperate Living, I do have to tell you,